الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا أرحم الراحمين. Oh Allah, teach us what benefit us, increase us in knowledge, in good morals and in good deeds, ya رب العالمين. We continue by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings, reflecting on the life of Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu, and as we are wrapping up his blessed life, we're gonna talk about his important statements in regard with marriage and the marital life, especially that we know he has some special things radiallahu anhu that are famous about him. We can start with his care. Of course, we cannot cover everything, but we'll take some of his famous statements. He, for example, urged the Muslims to get married, and he also focused on making marriage easy. And this is, I don't know about the non-Arab world, but in the Arab world, it's really, really, the Muslims are making it really difficult to get married. And that is against the sunnah of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and against the way of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So he used to urge the Muslims to get married and to make marriage really easy. For example, he says in the authentic hadith narrated by Imam al-Bayhaqi, by Allah, a man will not get after Islam anything better than a woman, a good woman who has a good character and who gives children and who has good morals. So the best thing after Islam is to have a righteous wife, a good wife. And this is from the hadith of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam as well. And nothing after associating partners with Allah is worse than having a woman with a wife with bad morals and with a hard tongue. He also, radiallahu anhu, and this is very famous about him, as mentioned by Imam Abdul Razzaq, that he used to dislike that Muslims get married to non-Muslims. That Muslims get married to non-Muslim women. We know Muslims are allowed to get married to Christian and Jews, but with the condition that they are chaste women. We're not allowed to get married to any Christian or Jew, and this is something many Muslims are unaware of. In the Quran, Allah says, وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ, that the chaste and the pure ones from among those who were given the book, means the Jews and Christians. You are not allowed to get married to any Christian woman, girl, or any Christian Jew. No, there are conditions. She has to be a chaste woman, a chaste girl, a pure girl who is not involved in the haram stuff. So he, radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Umar, urged the Sahaba not to get married to the non-Muslim women. He did not tell them it's haram, but he used to urge them not to do it. Why? For many reasons. First of all, to take care for the Muslim girls, right? If everyone will get married to those non-Muslim girls, what about the Muslim girls? What will happen to them, right? And also because he was afraid that Muslims will forget about the condition in getting married to the non-Muslim girls, which is what? That the fact that they have to be chaste girls, they have to be good ones. Radiallahu anhu wa arda. And this is in a clear hadith when he told Hudhaifa, Sayyidina Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu, he advised him not to get married to them. Also, he urged us, radiallahu anhu, according to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not to make the dowry difficult and the dowry big amount. Because that will make marriage difficult on the boys. So what did he do, radiallahu anhu? He said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not give anyone in marriage, did not give any man in marriage from among his family, and did not get married to any woman with more than 12 pieces of silver. the piece or uqiyah in Arabic in their measurement, which is about 119 grams. So 119 grams times 12, so the total will be about 50 ounces of silver, which is about $750 in our day. So he never gave marriage to anyone with a dowry more than approximately, as I calculated, $750. $750 is not a really difficult amount of money to get, right? So that is the maximum, right? Now some people, they make it really like huge amounts that really the young men cannot afford, and that is not permissible. And the honor of the women is not that they get a big dowry, right? We know our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we know Sayyidah Fatima, his daughter, we know what dowry she got, right? Just a shield that Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Ali had. So the best of women, Sayyidah Fatima radiallahu anha, her dowry was very simple, very easy, right? So who is greater than her radiallahu anha? There's no one who is greater than her. So that is very important. So he said, do not exaggerate in the dowry, in the gift of the women. Because if it was an honor for any woman, or if it is pious, then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have done that before you, right? And he mentioned the hadith, as narrated by Imam Abd al-Razzaq in his Musannaf, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not give anyone in marriage or married anyone with more than 12 uqiyah of silver. Also, radiyallahu anhu, there's a famous story that he wanted to limit or specify the dowry. He wanted to, he urged people, but it seems people were not listening, so he wanted to put a limit, that no one can exceed that limit. This is not very authentic story, but it could be authentic. It could have happened. And the scholars, they narrated, and we heard it from our sheikhs many times. So he spoke in his khutbah, radiallahu anhu, that do not exaggerate in the dowries of women. And if I hear about anyone who is asking or paying for more than what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did, means more than those 12 pieces of silver, which is about $750, except that I'm going to make the extra amount of money for the Muslim treasury. I'm going to take that extra amount, put it in the Muslim treasury. Then a woman got up. All the Sahaba who were there, they were silent. No one objected on him. But a woman from the back, she got up. And she said, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, O leader of the believers, is it your statement that we have to follow, or the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He said, what? And subhanAllah, look, and our Sheikh, the Grand Mufti, the late Grand Mufti of Syria, he used to say this a lot. This is the story that a woman, she got up and she stopped the president of the state. All of the, like, it's like a parliament, right? All of the Sahaba, no one objected. But a woman got up and objected. Now in democracy, the rule for who? The majority, right? But in Islam, doesn't work. In Islam, the majority is not always right. The woman said, Allah says in the Quran, if you give one of them a qintar, then don't take anything from it. If you give your women a dowry, which is an amount, a certain amount, a qintar, don't take anything from it. Then she said, do you know how much is that amount? He said, no. She said, then how can you limit it? Allah says, Allah does not limit it. How do you want to limit it? Then he said, the woman was right and Umar was wrong. He said, the woman was right and Umar was wrong. And then he just urged them that don't exaggerate in the dowries of women. Radiallahu anhu arda. So what humbleness he has, radiallahu anhu, when he returns to the truth, even if a lady in the back, she reminds him, he listens. So it's not about the majority always, right? Also, very famous and important ruling that people mention about Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, they say, it is Sayyidina Umar who stopped or who forbade the marriage of Mut'ah. which is a type of marriage that was permissible in a certain circumstance in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it was forbidden until the day of judgment, as in the authentic hadith narrated by Imam Muslim, where you get married to a woman with agreement to a certain time. Then it was permissible for a certain amount of time, then it was forbidden until the day of judgment. So some people did not know about this ruling, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam completely forbade this type of marriage. So in the time of Sayyiduna Abu Bakr and Sayyiduna Umar, some people, they wanted to do this type of marriage. And Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu forbade them and reminded them. But some people come now and say, it's Sayyiduna Umar who forbade it. But that is absolutely not right. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the one who forbade it completely, and that ruling was abrogated until the day of judgment, as in the authentic ahadith. But some people, they did not know that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam abrogated it, and then Sayyiduna Umar reminded people and made it sure that they don't do this type of marriage, because marriage is to continue. Marriage is a life choice, is to make it persistent, not like for a certain amount of time. Marriage is to build family, to build the community, etc. Another very nice and important story from Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu, authentic story narrated by Imam Bayhaqi. You can take 4 more minutes inshallah, since now it's getting late. He was going in one of the nights roaming the streets of Al-Madinah, as we mentioned many times. A great leader, a responsible leader radiallahu anhu, he will go around and roam the street of Al-Madinah to make sure people are safe, people are secure, everything is going right, everything is settled. That is the leader, the true leader. So he heard a woman from inside her house, she was saying a type of some verses of poetry. She was saying, this night has been so long and made me concerned and worried. My beloved is not here so that I spent some time with him. So she showed in her poetry that she was missing her husband. So he radiallahu anhu came back home, and he asked his daughter Sayyida Hafsa radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that how much time can a woman show patience for the departure or the separation from between her and her husband. So she said about 6 or 4 months. So he radiallahu anhu, he said, I'm not gonna leave an army for more than 6 months in the borders, or at the borders, or in a battle. There's a battle going, defending the Muslim land, or a Muslim soldier at the borders, protecting the borders of the Muslims. I'm not gonna leave him more than 6 months. So what did he do? He started doing shifts so that people go back to their spouses and give them their right and take the care of their needs. Also, one famous ruling about Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu is about divorce of 3 in 1. This is extremely important. Imam Muslim narrates from Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma that divorce in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and in the time of Abu Bakr, and some years, 2 years of the Khilafah of Sayyidina Umar, the rule or the reign of Sayyidina Umar, it was the 3 considered as 1. Like if someone, a hasty husband, an ignorant husband, a husband who doesn't fear Allah, who did not learn the rulings of marriage, he makes a divorce 3 times at once. He divorces his wife 3 times at once, in one place, one session. That is forbidden. That is haram. It's forbidden because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, At-talaqu marratan, divorce is 2 times. You make one, then the woman has her iddah, then if you insist and the iddah ends, then you can do another one, etc. And there are rulings. There are times in which it's haram to make the divorce. There is a certain time that every husband and wife have to learn. If your wife is in her menses, it's haram to divorce her. Some Muslims, they don't care, they did not even learn. It's haram to divorce her if she's in her menses. If she's pure, but you had a relationship with her in that purity time, it's haram to divorce her in that time. You have to wait until she has her menses, then she's purified again and you don't have relation with her. You see, there are certain rulings clear in Islam, and still many spouses, they're unaware of it. And they divorce and they think that's okay. It's haram. And before even divorce, there are many, at least 4 steps you have to take. Now we're holding a whole course on marriage and these issues that are extremely important. So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though it's haram to divorce like 3 times at once, as is famous in so many parts of the Muslim world, like in Syria, it's common, unfortunately. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr and 2 years of Sayyidina Umar's time, even though if someone does it 3 times at once, it is haram, it's forbidden, but it will be considered as one. It will be considered as one time, one divorce. But Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, he said, people have been hasty in something that Allah has given them a chance in. So they don't want this chance from Allah to have a divorce like 3 times or 2 times. They want to do it just at once. So we will just give them what they want. So he will judge that if someone divorces 3 times at once, he will make it a final divorce. He will make it 3. And in many authentic hadith, he will punish the husband who does this, and he will make separation between the wife and husband. Why? Because Allah is telling you, you do once, then you don't care, so you have to be punished for that. And now the vast majority of the Muslim scholars and the Muslim jurist schools, they take his opinion. They take his opinion. Still, if there are divorce issues, it has to be referred to as a trustworthy and knowledgeable sheikhs. So, no one should take a fatwa just from a class or a lecture about divorce. These are very important issues that you have to go to a sheikh who is a trustworthy, who is knowledgeable. And every case has its own rulings. But this is the general case. It is forbidden to do it this way. And Sayyidina Umar made it a final divorce because people did not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they did not take the chance and the permissibility and the flexibility that Allah gave them. These are some of the main issues about marriage from Sayyidina Umar's life and statements. And I urge everyone to attend, if you are about to get married or you are already married, to attend the marriage course that we're holding and to learn about the rights and the responsibilities of the spouse and all of these rulings and how to solve the marital problems, etc., etc. That is extremely important, and it's mandatory on the Muslim to learn these rules so that you don't wrong your spouse. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to seek knowledge and to benefit from the knowledge that we learn, and make us of those who listen to the speech and follow its best. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless for us this month of Sha'ban and help us to reach Ramadan and worship Him in Ramadan and accept Ramadan from us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give relief to our brothers and sisters who are suffering everywhere. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakumullahu khair.